Welcome again to the another learning video, and right now this video is all about vegetable gardening. So a vegetable garden is an intensive type of growing vegetables to minimize buying from the market and provide continuous supply of fresh and nutritious vegetables for the family. So the importance of the vegetable garden or the vegetable gardening is it can contribute to family nutrition. Aside from that, it can also help reduce cash outlay for food. It also eliminates the need to procure financing loans to be able to produce vegetables. Aside from the tree, it also provides additional income if there is a surplus of your produce, and provides good exercise and leisure time. It gives opportunity for the family to work together and strengthen ties. And also, it encourages cooperation among neighbors. So the vegetable gardening actually have four types. So we have number one, home garden, which is a garden done in home by the family members. We have also a school garden, a garden that is done in school. Community garden, of course, done in the community. And the last but not the least type is the growing containers. It is done when you have no available arable space to conduct gardening. You will do it in container, especially if it is happens in the urban areas. So vegetable gardening, we also plan ahead of making a garden. So planning a garden involves site selection also. So for convenience, locate the garden near the house, school building, or community center. It can be in the back, front, or side of the house depending upon the space availability. In site selection, also consider locate a site that is near a water source. Choose an open area that will allow the plants to receive sunshine at least for half day. Choose also fairly level ground, terrace if otherwise, and use well-drained soil and raise the beds during rainy season for better drainage. That's the conditions if you're going to select a site for your vegetable gardening. Planning a garden also involves size of a garden. So for a home-sized garden, the size depends on size of your family. Big family will have more labor for gardening. Also, the available land and the time of availability. In school gardens, size depends on 5 to 10 square meter per lot for elementary school pupils, and much bigger size for agricultural high schools and college students for about 15 to 20 square meter. But you can, it depends, it can be still above that standard if you wish. In community garden, size depends on available land for a neighborhood. It varied from square meters to a hectare. It depends to the community and the available land of the community and the available labor in the community. Planning a garden, so garden planning involved also selection of vegetables. So the conditions, select vegetables that are preferred and likely to be eaten. Select a variety of vegetables with nutritional diversity and that are easy to manage. And also select a vegetables that are productive, and not just productive but also tolerant to common pests and diseases. Garden planning also involved, or you should also involve your planting plan. So in planting plan, like what can you see in the screen is somehow like that. You can plant May to July, the sweet potato, and then a fallow period, then on December to February, you plant another crops, which is tomato. You should make a variety or diverse crop so that you have a diverse produce in a year-long production. So also do relay cropping to assure continuous year-round supply of vegetables. Example, tomato with sweet corn. Also, intercrop vegetables with different maturity durations to assure also continuous year-round supply of vegetables. Example given here is cabbage and sweet corn. You can also have your planting plan, depends on your taste, depends on your choice, but make it sure that you will have a planting plan so that you will know what will you going to plant next or what you are going to relay or to intercrop with your crops during your planting time. Planning a garden also involves the fencing. So the benefit of fencing, it protects a garden from stray animals. Also, they also serve as a trellis for climbing vegetables at what can you see in the picture, hitting two birds at the same time. So planning a garden also involves planting calendar. This is the example of planting calendar. This is based on a research and it's a scientific way of planting of different crops, the calendar. So the better gourd, you can plant them January, also May, June, July, the best season or the best time for them to grow, also October, November, December. You can relay this planting calendar because it is a reliable and viable one. For example, for another example is the lettuce. If you want lettuce, you can plant it September to January during the cold season. For the May and June, actually you have many choices here. Just follow the yellow dots. So another thing in planning a garden, you should have tools used in gardening. So because the right tool can help you save labor and time and money. So for clearing the land, you can use different tools like bolo. For digging and leveling and ridging, you can have the shovel, the rakes, the hoe. For spraying, this is it. For weeding and cultivation, for watering, and for pruning. Actually, in agriculture and gardening, there are so many tools. You should use it appropriately based on their functions. So, requirements for successful gardening. So, the appearance, the yield, and other characteristics of vegetables or the phenotype result from the contribution of their genetic constitution or the genotype, its immediate environment, and the combined effects, the interaction of these two factors. So, this is the equation. So, again, if you want to have a good phenotype result of your vegetable of your crops, you should have the good contribution of genotype, the environment, and the interaction of genotype in the environment so that you will have or will produce a desired phenotype of crops. So therefore, to be a successful vegetable gardener, one should have a good control of the genotype through the varieties one grows and environmental factors such as appropriate management. So also, one of the requirements for successful gardening is varieties. So the correct choice of a variety assures that gardener of a crop that is, if you're choosing a variety, it should be reliable, adapted. Number two, it should be productive, and last, of desirable quality. Actually, there are two types of plant variety. We have the open pollinated or the OP. Seeds of OP variety are produced by natural pollination through successive generation. Save seeds from the best plants for the next planting season. So this is actually mga open pollinated varieties are commonly practiced here in our rural areas. So, but there is another kind of variety to choose, which is the hybrid. So the seeds of hybrids are produced by controlled pollination of two distinct parents. So buy fresh seeds when needed. Actually, this hybrid, you can buy it in different agricultural stores in your locality. Aside from varieties, seeds is also one of the requirements for successful gardening. So a true seeds is a mature ovule that contains a very small plant embryo and usually a food storage tissue within the seed coat. So this is the example of the true seed. So select good seeds that are, you should select good seeds, damage free, free from the mixtures of other varieties, free from the seed borne diseases, and with good vigor and good germination capacity. So aside from the two seeds, the seeds is also referred to as cutting, the rhizome, the bulb, and the tuber. Aside from, again, from the varieties, from the seeds, so crop management is one of the major requirements for successful gardening also. So under crop management, we should consider also methods of planting vegetables. So there are two methods of planting vegetables. We have the direct seeding and transplanting. So the direct seeding, as what can you see in the picture, some seeds planted directly are okra, melons, beans, and carrots. Direct seeding is done because some seeds germinate rapidly and their seedlings grow fast. Number two reasons, some seeds are large, thus can be planted in a wide range of soil conditions. Some vegetables like carrots and radish have only one long top root system which, if damaged, will deform the root, and some have slow root germination capacity. So that's the reason why direct seeding is done in some crops like okra, that's what I said, melons, beans, and carrots. For transplanting, you are growing seed in a seed tray or in a nursery, then after a desirable days, you transplant it in your garden or in a container. So transplanting, some examples of plants that are transplanted are tomato, we have the eggplant, we have also the cabbage and the lettuce. So under crop management, which is our requirements for successful gardening, we should also consider the methods of raising seedlings. So there are three methods of raising the seedlings. We have the seedbed method, the seed box or the tray method, and the seedling container method. So the seedbed methods, in this method, seedlings are raised in beds when large quantities of seedlings are needed, as in community gardens. So here are the steps, technical steps and seedbed method of raising seedlings. So number one, so what can you see in the picture? Prepare the bed and improve the soil condition. Number two, sterilize the beds by burning rice straw on soil surface or by pouring boiling water on beds. After the step 1 and the step 2, you sow and cover now the seeds, as what can you see in the picture. 4. Cover with straw. 5. Water the bed using a fine sprinkler. Then the step 6, allow the seedlings to grow 5 cm apart. Then thin out excess seedlings when first true leaves have appeared. Number 7, use simple tour to protect seedlings against rain and sun. You can use, as what can you see in the picture, the nylon net in protecting the seedlings against the rain and sun. The another method is the seed box or tray method. In this method, seedlings are raised in a special made wooden boxes or plastic trays. So below are the steps in the seed box or tray method or raising seedlings. Please bear with me or follow after me. So in this picture, use the following growing media in equal proportion. You can use 1:1:1 ratio, 1 part soil, 1 part compost, and 1 part sand. After that, sterilize growing medium as in the seedbed method by burning rice straw or any straw or pouring boiling water in the growing medium. Number 3, you are now ready to sow and cover the seeds. Number 4, of course, this is important, water using fine sprinkler or watering can. And number 5, thin or break out excess seedlings when first true leaves have appeared. The last methods of raising seedlings is the seedling container method. So raising seedlings in separate pots or container gives 100% survival in the field since root injury is minimized. So the following seedling containers may be used. So you can use biodegradable materials like old banana leaves, other locally available materials such as paper pots, and you can also use the small plastic bags that are being bought in the agriculture supply or in the market. So here are the steps to follow in the seedling container method. It's just a simple step or way. Number 1, same. Use the same sterilized medium in equal proportion as in the seed box method. 1 part soil, 1 part compost, and 1 part sand. 2, you now sow and cover the seeds in the container. And after the seedlings grow, thin or prick out excess seedlings when first true leaves have appeared. Oh, so easy. So, under crop management, which is the requirements for successful gardening, we have also the transplanting. So after growing the seeds in the different method, the seedling method, the container method, and etc., you're now ready your seeds for transplanting. So 3 to 5 week old seedlings are ready for transplanting. So seedlings in the boxes are blocked into 5 cm by 5 cm to confine roots 7 to 10 days before transplanting. You should take note of that condition. For hardening, what is the purpose of hardening? Hardening is withdrawing water to slow down plant growth, resulting in thicker, less succulent, and harder plant tissues. Hardening seedlings are sturdy and requires no cover after transplanting. That's the benefit of hardening. So, if grown under partial shade, the hardening should be done by exposing seedlings to strong sunlight 1 to 2 weeks before transplanting. So, in land preparation, as also important factors in crop management. So, you should take note of these. Thorough land preparation creates favorable condition for seed germination. Number 2, seedling establishment and management of crops. Thorough land preparation also eliminates most of the weeds and soil-borne pathogenic microorganisms. Also improves water holding capacity of your garden, of your site, or of your area. Drainage also and aeration of the soil. So large seeds require less preparation than smaller seeds, while transplant and large cuttings require minimal amounts of land preparation. Here's how to do the land preparation, or how to prepare the land. This is the steps. Number 1, see the picture. Dig deep and turn over the soil. Pulverize soil clads until soil particles are of the proper size. Number 2, To improve soil texture, you should incorporate well-decomposed and sieved compost of farm manure at 2 kg or more per square meter. Number 3, step 3. If soil is too heavy, so you should incorporate fine sand until desired soil texture is obtained. After that, you can now incorporate part or all of the recommended fertilizers into the soil before planting. Number 5, dig holes in rows following the recommended spacing of crops, because we have different spacing of different crops. We have different required spacing. So, when to transplant? Transplant in the afternoon. This is very recommended during sunny days. How to transplant? So, carefully place the seedlings in the hole, then fill the hole with soil. After carefully placing the seedlings in the hole, you should gently press downward the seedlings to assure contact of roots with the soil. And the most important among them, irrigate newly transplanted seedling. Requirements for successful gardening under crop management is also the cultural practices. So, one of the cultural practices in vegetable gardening is bedding. Bedding provides drainage during rainy season. Putting space between beds serve as furrow irrigation during rainy season and walk away for gardener. So this is the example of making a bed or the bedding. Another cultural practices involved in the vegetable gardening is the trellising or staking. So, all viney vegetables are generally trellised. Trellising or staking facilitates irrigation, pest control, and harvesting. This helps produce better products by preventing contact between products and damp soil. So, use stakes for plants without ability to climb or to twine. So, if the plant have the ability to climb, you can use the trellising method. And if the plants don't have the capability to climb or to twine, stake the plants so that it can be stand alone during their growing period. Another cultural practice is the mulching. Mulching is practiced to what? To control soil temperature, prevent loss of soil moisture. Not just that, control weeds also, prevent soil compaction, prevent soil erosion, and prevent contact between products and damp soil. One of the cultural practices also is the pruning. In Lufa, pruning of the tip of the seedling stimulates early branching and fruiting in lower nodes. In indeterminate tomatoes, single-stem pruning produces large fruits. That's the benefit of pruning. Ratooning. Okra and eggplant produces an earlier crop compared when they started from seedlings. So you are ratooning the plants so that it will develop or rejuvenate its new parts for the next cycle of cropping. Another cultural practice is use of protected cultivation. So in the picture, low tunnels covered with clear plastic sheets or nylon nets are simple structures now commonly used in vegetable gardens. The plastic sheets protect the crop against excessive rains. In protective cultivation, you can also use nylon nets because it decreases wind speed, break the force of raindrops like what can you see in the picture, the setup, and prevent mechanical damage to the leaves. So short maturing vegetables have been successfully grown under this structure. Example of vegetables grown under protective cultivation are petchay, mustard, the kangkong, the bunching onions, and the spinach. So, in soil and fertilizer management, so vegetables needs nutrients as what people also do. They need carbon, the vegetables need carbon and oxygen from the air, hydrogen from the water, and the mineral nutrients from the soil. So vegetables require major nutrients such as nitrogen, N, phosphorus, B, and potassium, K, in large amount, and require minor nutrients in small amounts. So why use fertilizer? Fertilizers contain nutrients which are food for plants. The N, we have the nitrogen. The purpose of the nitrogen is needed for healthy growth of leaves and flowers. P for phosphorus is good for root and stem development. Potassium is for better leaves, stems, and flowers, and the other nutrients are for better growth and development. But these nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium are needed by the vegetables in large amounts to complete its cycle and to have a good produce. So the fertilizers are either organic or inorganic. So organic fertilizers contain nutrients in small concentration. The reaction in the organic fertilizer is slow, therefore it takes time before the results are observed. Organic fertilizers improve soil texture and biological properties of the soil. They are best applied when mixed with inorganic fertilizers. So example of the organic fertilizers is the compost. It's a mixture of all kinds of organic waste such as straw, leaves, ash, manure, and kitchen scraps that have undergone decomposition. It is highly beneficial for soil and plant growth. So, rapid composting. In rapid composting, microorganisms such as trichoderma are used to hasten decomposition. The amount of materials may be adjusted proportionately. Here are the steps in rapid composting. So, in doing rapid composting, number one step is chop or shred crop residues and weeds into small pieces. Then, you can pulverize or break lumps of manure into fine pieces. After that, these ingredients are mixed with 250 grams trichoderma activator for every 1 ton crop residues and 0.5 ton animal manure. Then, mix thoroughly with the substrates. 4. Pile the mixture in bed. Do not compress the pile so that more air will enter and the decomposition process will be faster. Number 5. Cover the pile with transparent plastic sheet of any color except black. Why? To keep the pile moist so that decomposition will not slow down. Step 6. Let the pile remain stable or undistributed for 10 days. If the outer layer dries up, you should spray water every 5 days. 7th step. On the 11th to 15th day, turn the pile upside down to allow the bottom layer to be on top, while the outer layers on the inside. Mature or ripe compost will ripen in 35 to 60 days and should look like dark brown to black soil. There should be no foul smell or bad odor. So step 8, you can now directly apply your mature compost to the soil as fertilizer. Vermicomposting is also one of the type of composting under organic fertilizer. So vermicomposting is a type of composting in which certain species of earthworms, example of it is the African night crawlers, are used to enhance the process of organic waste conversion and produce a better end product. Vermicomposting is a mesophilic process where utilizing of microorganisms and earthworms are done. So, earthworm feeds the organic waste material and passes it through their digestive system and gives out in a granular forms or the cocoons, which is known as vermicompost. So, the steps in vermicomposting are 1. Prepare the bed by constructing a bamboo slats. Number 2. Line the bed with plastic sheet to prevent vermes from escaping. Then you pile all waste materials on the bed, better the shredded one. 4. Water the bed, then cover with plastic sheet. 5. Remove the plastic sheet cover after 10 to 14 days and place the vermis on the bed. 6. Now you can harvest the vermicompost by hand or by using screen after 30 to 45 days. So, as what I've said before, there are two types of fertilizer. So we have the organic fertilizer, and now we're going to discuss about inorganic fertilizers. So inorganic fertilizers are commercially manufactured mineral nutrients. So these contain high nutrient concentration, which is readily soluble and takes a shorter time for plants to absorb, thus showing immediate effect on plant growth. So these are available in different combination of mineral nutrients. So the numbers on bag labels, like what can you see in the picture, refer to the percentage by weight of mineral nutrients. For example, the complete fertilizer, this is known as the triple 14. So we have the first percentage is the nitrogen, the middle percentage is the phosphorus, and the last percentage that found in the bag of your inorganic fertilizers that are sold in the market are the potassium. For example, in the complete fertilizer, it is read as 14-14-14. That means there are 14% of nitrogen in that inside the bag, 14% potassium, phosphorus, and 14% K or the potassium. In urea, the percentage is 45% nitrogen, 0% phosphorus, and 0% potassium. So the urea, in technical term, in technical side, contains only the 45% nitrogen inside the bag, and the rest are fillers. The 0060 or the muriate of potash, we have zero. There are no nitrogen content in the bag of muriate of potash, and there are also no phosphorus content in the muriate of potash. And in the muriate of potash, we can only have the potassium, which is 60%. The 40% inside the bags is the filler. Yes. So this is the example. The nitrogen, the key nutrient in plant growth. So if you're going to solve it, for example, in the given example, 21-30-20. So 21% of nitrogen in a 50 pounds bag is equals to 10.5 pounds of nitrogen. Same as in the phosphorus, in 3% phosphorus in a 50 pound bag, it's only have 1.5 pounds of phosphorus. For the potassium, in 20% in a 50 pound bag, it contributes or only to 10 pounds potassium inside that bag. That's how you compute for the amount of NPK. So that's it for the part 1 of vegetable gardening, and I will going to upload the next part 2 to continue or to make the vegetable gardening into a whole process. So for now, that's the part 1, and hope you get different ideas or different informations about vegetable gardening in part 1. So stay tuned for the part 2. Thank you guys for watching.